memories of David.
Greetings in the name of the Lord Jesus. For those of you who might not know or recognize me, I'm Boyd Dunleavy, and my wife Denise and I live in Ontario. But I was David and Vera's firstborn grandson, and this is my sister Kate, and my heart is so thrilled to be here as a 44-year-old. For my nearly 96-year-old grandfather's funeral. I remember as a child many happy memories, staying over at grandma and granddad's, the just joy and insanity of when they share that home with the Campbells, and the dogs and the children and the cousins, and it just seemed like it never stopped. We were just more cousins, and so I'm just so thrilled to see all of you here. My wife sends her greetings. When Grandma's cancer diagnosis in the 80s, we didn't know how long she would have, and it was here 19 years ago that we had her funeral. And my wife and I got engaged at that time, and Granddad married us in 2001, and we genuinely, sincerely thought that we would be coming here for a funeral in the near future. We had moved from Toronto to London, Ontario in 2002, and in the process of moving, we got a phone call that we need to come British Columbia, and we thought, as Granddad passed, but no, he had met a wonderful young lady sitting right there, and Grandma Yuna, you gave us, didn't give Granddad 17 beautiful years. You would have never met my children. He had a new lease on life. His marrying us, he was there, but he was not himself. It seemed to have aged him. And this new, younger man in his 80s, it was just absolutely incredible. I don't want to talk too long, but my granddad had such a crazy, insane sense of humor. My son, Stephen, was recognized just the past month with excellence in school, and his teacher came to me and said he's very witty, and I said, well, that's his great grandfather, and he's my son is Stephen David. On a side note, there's a few Daves here, a lot of us actually, and yeah, like that. These are the Daves I know, but I'll finish with when we came here in 2005. Stephen was 6 months old, and you know how fussy babies can be since there's a beautiful little Dave right there, and he started crying, and so Granddad, in his sense of humor, he said, oh, that must come from the mother's side. It was just constant humor. We knew this day would come, but I can't believe that this is in 2019, and so you know, from life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands our destiny. We're well, we bring greeting, and thank you for your time.
I'm going to try to not sob and cry. I'm the second oldest granddaughter. So the third grandchild, and some of my earliest memories of my granddad are his low voicing rock star being the grandchild of Reverend David Cline, because he was a celebrity. And I felt so special having access to his office at Brick House. I could just go there anytime. I loved the smell of all of his old books and the unique smell of Granddad in that office. He taught me how to drive a car. He was so patient and laughing. And this never-ending supportive of all of and any endeavors of all of his grandchildren. He took literally millions of photos, if anybody knows him. Always taking a picture with his terrible little cameras. And was so, so proud and steady of all of us. And I just want to read from 2 Timothy, because I think it's so very much him. And it says, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have loved his appearing and been faithful." And I think that is something that characterizes him so much. Is he was so steady and so faithful. And I know that he's just having an amazing time in heaven right now, and we look forward to that hope as well.
And because I cry easily, I am just going to read my cousin David's message. David Morgan says, "My wife Linda and all of our family join in offering our deepest sympathy in the death of the last of the Morgan siblings and spouses. He was a man filled with faith, a true gentleman, and a loyal supporter of all his family and extended family. We appreciate that you provided a loving home for our grandmother, Laura Morgan. After our grandfather died in 1955, for 9 years, we have many good memories, family visits with your family and ours in the early years. We're sorry to be unable to attend the service, but our love and prayers are with all of you as you honor this wonderful man, your father and my uncle."
Thanks so much to the Alba and the children for sharing those memories with us. Our next song is going to be "In Christ Alone," and I think that's one of the songs that David also would share with us as people, that you can only find your salvation in Christ alone. There's no other way to do that. So let's sing that as in honor of David, saying that in Christ alone truly we will find the way to live. And let's join the singing.
Christ, Lord, my Lord. plans, and by noble deeds he stands. He's a shelter from the wind, a refuge from the storm. He's streams of water in a dry land, and the shadow of a great rock in an arid land. That's our Father. That's who he was for us and for all of you. And I know he would want us to say thank you for coming, for being here.
I'm just going to make a couple of introductory remarks, and then Anne's going to give her tribute to her dad. Is it 45 minutes or 45 minutes? I can allow it.
We have our watch here.
The Christian faith gives ultimate value to life.
Amen.
And good values to live by.
Amen.
These were two of the overarching principles that Granddad taught us when we first came to faith in midlife. My recollection is, we had been in the world, living in the world, and then we got into the New Age, meditation, and yoga. And my recollection is that he said, you have some pretty strange ideas about God. You need to get into Bible study. So he put us into a two-year Bible study, but it included studying the scriptures, but then he also gave us the overarching great themes: God's faithfulness, our need for his redemption, his overpowering love, the capacity of the Holy Spirit to transform our life.
Amen.
And he got us off to a good start. And then as we went along, he continued to guide us and got us into the concept of sanctification, taking your issues to Christ, not projecting them onto other people, doing the inner work, which was for me being courageous about being vulnerable. Other people have other issues, anger, resentment, bitterness, but that was the big one for me, and it still is, but here I am being vulnerable. I just want to share one more thing. My brother really bonded with Dad. They had so much in common. They were both in the service. Dad, of course, in World War II, a day much later. They shared a deep faith in Christ, and they were pilots. And I just want to tell one very quick story, then it's Anne's turn. At one point, Dave took Dad up in his Beechcraft Baron, which is a twin-engine plane, and I think they flew around Bellingham, out over the islands, and then Dave turned the controls over to Dad, and as he was doing so, he was telling him about all the instruments. This is this, and this is that, and Dad reached over and over the intercom said to him, "It's all right, Dave, I'll just divide everything by two." Here's Anne.
So, Dad loved scripture, and I remember him being sent to many churches that were failing, and he would come back shaking his head and saying, "I can't believe their ministers don't even know anything of the gospel. They don't know any scripture." He knew why the congregations were failing, because it's our bedrock. Scripture is God-breathed. He believed in sharing the blessings that he'd received. And he taught us when we did that Bible study with him, one year in the Old Testament, one year in the New Testament, he taught us that we were blessed to be a blessing. And through us, all people in the world should be blessed. And that is how he lived his life. That's his legacy to us. That's what we have, is service, to serve and to love. He taught us that God made man in his image, and that we are really a crown of splendor in God's hand. And he taught us that not only men were made in God's image, but women.
Amen.
He liked women. He liked strong women. He never was one of those men who said, "I'm the head of the house, and I'm making the decisions." Mom was an equal partner. When he married Una, he got a really strong woman who'd done all sorts of amazing things around the world. So he chose women who would give him their opinion. When I was a teenager, I said to him on one of the rare occasions when it was just me and Dad, there were always so many people around, but we had a time in the car, and I said to him, "I don't think I can be one of those little women in the kitchen, barefoot and pregnant and just staying home." And he said, "You can do anything you set your mind to. Go ahead. Be a woman who leads." Yeah. He did teach us that we are to mutually submit. It was a misreading of scripture that says only the man is to be in charge. He said we are to mutually submit to each other. And really, the husbands have to do more than the wife, because they have to lay down their life like Christ laid his life down for the church. So he said, you know, women only have to respect their husband, but the man has to really give it up. And our dad did. I mean, I remember Dad coming home from work and ironing his own shirts, vacuuming, getting up at breakfast time, and Mom had a hard time getting up for breakfast. And so he made his porridge every morning. He served wherever he could serve. Mom was a lot of fire and passion. She loved the Lord. And sometimes fire and passion can turn into a little bit of legalism. And when I abandoned the faith, and she was very upset with me, she told him I would never darken their door again. She would never let me back in the house. And he said, no, you are not doing that. And he taught us Luke 15. It's about the prodigals. It's about the lost son, the lost sheep, the lost coin. Always God is wanting us to come back to him. And that was my father, you know. In the prodigal son, the father is longing. He's looking for his child. And when his son comes, he runs to him. And that's how it was with my dad. He loved family. And he was not about to abandon me, even though I'd abandoned the faith. Actually, the last 2 weeks of his life, I read him the Gospel of John, and I came up, I think every day, most days anyway. And by the end, he couldn't talk. You didn't know really if he was hearing you or not, because he just stared off into space. But I was reading through the Gospel of John, and I came to a section about the Pharisees. And I thought, ooh, that's not very uplifting. Maybe I'll just skip the section. But I knew he would know that I hadn't read that chapter. So I started to read it, and this was a few days after he had just been immobile for so long, and he went like this. He didn't like the Pharisees. He didn't like legalism. Yeah. So he taught us that Jesus' first and greatest commandment is love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. And that is how he lived. That is what he did. He loved anyone who was in his sphere of influence. But one thing Dad did not love was being a counselor to his congregation. Dad was one of those people who just, you know, you come in with your litany of woes, and Dad said, okay, let's fix it. He moved quickly from problem to solution, and most people couldn't do that. So when we moved up here from the States, Rick has a PhD in counseling, and Dad was so delighted. He set Rick up in an office in their church and sent all of his people to Dan to deal with. So, you want to say something, don't you? This is our second daughter. Our first daughter was not able to come at such short notice. She lives in California. And our third daughter is there with her baby. Ah, there he is.
I heard a song, and since then it has always had a special place in my heart. On my 10th
the summer before last on his birthday while we were in the hospital. So we thought it was only fitting that we give him the same song we always have for the celebration of his life.
I'm Elizabeth. The last time I saw Grandpa, he could no longer speak, and so I sat with him holding his hand and singing every hymn I could think of, just as I had with Grandma Vera 19 years ago. And of course, the final song I sang him before I left that day was the Tennessee Waltz. He nodded his head and it seemed like he was trying to sing along. As he began to decline over the last couple of years, he expressed several times to Jane and I that he was at peace with dying, only he worried about two things. He worried for his son, Chris, who struggles with many hardships, and he didn't want to leave dear Una behind. I mentioned Chris for Grandpa's sake, because he loved and cared for him, and his heart ached for him as only a parent's can until the end. And for Grandma Una, we dedicate this song. You surely were the comfort and the love of his old age. And Finn?
He was a great man and he had a wonderful life.
About the wondrous name of Jesus. die on the cross for us.
Dad was a wonderful man, and my favorite story about Dad is whenever summer we'd go to the farm, and on the way there, back then, you couldn't get music 24 hours a day, you could only get it sometimes. And so when we were driving from Calgary to the farm, there would be no radio. And so what happened, we would sing, and my dad could sing harmony, and my sisters would sing, and I would sit beside my dad, and we would sing this high harmony, and it was so fun. We would sing, "Green Roll the Rushes Home." And I can't remember the words now, but it was fun to do it. It went on for, what, 12 verses or something, so, you know. And the other thing I found very funny was my mother would always have a foster baby, and especially when Chris was a baby, before we adopted him. You know, there was no such thing as paper diapers. So my mother would wash the diapers and then they'd hang out the sides of the windows of the car.
Yeah.
So I always thought that was very funny. So I'm not going to say much because I was always very shy. Being the middle one, I was trying to get along with everyone, so I'd sort of not say anything. I might think something, but I wouldn't say it because I knew, you know, they might not like what I had to say, so I wouldn't say it. So Dad, he gave me, this is my favorite verse, and this is what Dad gave to me. "Be bold, be brave, for the Lord your God is with you." And then I was reading this story, and I thought it was really great because they said joy. And this is how Dad was. Joy stands for Jesus, others, yourself. And it was wonderful. Every night, he would read the scriptures with the Eugenia, wouldn't he? And he loved the scriptures. And we've all learned from him, and it was so wonderful to our family.
Funny, he was well versed with words and a great storyteller. He always had funny stories that he wanted us to listen to. I was honored by his great faith in Jesus, how he always lived for him no matter what the cost. He always told me that I'd meet my dream girl, and then the day that I came over, before my date with Alicia, he said, myself, wait, my mom said the same thing to me that day too. And so he was right, and he knew good character. Granddad, we will miss your cheery smile and the twinkle in your eyes, and you will be missed dearly, Granddad. And then because my wife Alicia is in the hospital, my sister-in-law Mariah will speak for her.
Hi, I'm Mariah. I'm James' sister-in-law. So I'm going to share something that Alicia wrote for Granddad on her behalf. Granddad was warm and friendly with a great sense of humor. He always had a cheery smile that would warm up the room. I admired his faith in God. He was like a third grandpa to me. I always enjoyed when we went out to the pantry with Granddad. When we found out that the pantry was closing, he said, "That won't just do. Granddad, we will miss you, but thank God you are now burning up in heaven with Jesus. We can now rest assured that." Love, Alicia.
I am Mark. I am the middle child. I have many good memories of Granddad. Many times of coming over to visit with him, playing cards, hearing stories of Uncle Shorty, who apparently was a notorious card cheat. And he had so much life and so much humor. It was just a joy to be with him. I remember especially one story that he told me. He told me about a man who had decided that he was going to paint his house. And now when he went and looked in his shed, he found that he only had one can of paint. It was a big house. He thought, well, one can of paint is only going to do one side of the house. And he thought, wait, I've got lots of paint thinner. I'll just, you know, thin the paint. It'll be great. So he started this off. He thinned the paint out. And now he had two cans of paint. He started painting the house. He got halfway through, and he looked down, and he's like, oh, I don't have enough paint. So he said, wait, the paint thinner, yes. So he went and he thinned the paint again. And he was nearing the end, but he still had one more wall of paint. But he looked down, no more paint. And so he went and grabbed the thinner, and as he grabbed it, God spoke down from heaven and said to him, repaint, repaint, and thin no more. So,
I don't know how close to stand to this. It seems like I'm at the proper distance. Hi, I'm Andrew. I'm the third and youngest child of Janice and Ed, youngest brother of James and Mark. This is my wife, Ruthie. It's kind of hard to know what words to say. Sometimes when you have a relative, or sometimes when you have someone that you love very much, the words kind of stick in your throat a little bit. But when it comes to thinking about Granddad David, I just remember just nothing but love and warmth. No matter where I was with him at any time, at any family gathering, at any, maybe part of that was because a lot of it came in the summer, but just every moment with David was just full of warmth and just full of that wry sense of humor that he had, that little thing that he would say that he'd think about for a second and then he'd have that little smile on his face. I'm going to miss his wit. I'm going to miss just the warmth that he showed to me all my life. And I'm sure everyone here will too. But we've been so blessed to know him, been so blessed to just be with him. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. Now, Ruthie just wants to share.
I'm sorry, I have to read off with my phone. I've never really been close to any of my biological grandfathers. My mom's dad lived far away, and I rarely got to see him. My dad's dad died before I was born, and even though my grandma remarried, I never really got to see him or get to know him either. Then I met Granddad Cline. We met while Andrew and I were dating. It was very important to Andrew that his family all meet.
when we are engaged, he congratulated on bringing him a sweet and pretty newest granddaughter who could sing too. He called me his granddaughter. That meant more to me than he could possibly know. He congratulated me on every accomplishment as if I was his. Conversations with him were always stimulating. He had a quiet voice, but a sharp wit, even as he aged. He was one of the first to hold my son at 10 days old. I have that picture and I cherish it. His face lit up whenever we brought his great-grandchildren to see him. Granddad and Grandma Yuna's homes were always places that I will hold in fond memory in my heart. You are not just Andrew's granddad, you are mine. Not just through marriage, but in my heart, always. I love you, Granddad. You can rest now, knowing you have lived well and have left an amazing legacy behind. I know where you are, and we will see you one day.
Father, he was an amazing pastor and leader. Such a good impact on my wife. She wanted to marry a pastor and leader. You know, sometimes they're running in a different direction. And David mentored me and many other young pastors about leadership. He taught me there's always going to be conflict. You have to stay calm and be quick on your feet. David in Saskatchewan, he looked after one of those 3-point churches, and one of those buildings, the roof always leaked, and nobody was willing to deal with that. And David finally put his foot down and he said, we're not going to start the service until we deal with the leaking roof. And you know, everybody hid their wallets and purses, and they were in silence for about half an hour. And finally, the resident tightwad in the choir, you know, about preaching to the choir, he said, well, I want the service to start, so I'll give $50. And at that point, a huge chunk of plaster came from the ceiling, hit him on the head, and knocked him down below the pew. And he kind of vaguely brought himself up, and he said, with a quiet voice, I meant to say 500. And David, being quick on his feet, he said, hit him again, Lord. That's actually a joke that David taught me. Most of what you're hearing today, this is probably like preaching to the choir. You've heard this again. It never hurts to hear it again, so it can get to our heart. Jesus loves you.
Singing A New Jerusalem by David Clifton and Andy Pearson.
so much for sharing. Let us now sing hymn number 345, Blessed Assurance. And we all know that we accept Christ Jesus as our Savior. There's a blessed assurance in that, that we will go to heaven and that we will inherit eternal life. So let us sing hymn number 345. So much. It's always good to listen to the 23rd Psalm. Let us hear words from Susan Cline, John Charles Cline, and Randy Cline.
Good day, everyone. I'm honored to I will always be known as Susie Cline to David's family. Not Susan, always Susie. My late father, Peter Cline, was his older brother. And the family farm in Zelma, Saskatchewan, where Uncle Dave and my dad and their siblings grew up, is the same place that I grew up and my sisters and brother grew up. It was a place of great bonding between families. As a child, I remember our aunts and uncles and their families coming to spend time at the farm. My grandparents and parents shared a farmyard, and the houses buzzed with activity. I would wait for the arrival of my cousins to play with. And I recall Uncle Dave's car would jet down our long driveway. It was a long driveway, as anyone knows that's been there, a long dirt driveway. And we as children waiting all day for our cousins to arrive, we would wait sort of gathered by the road thinking that we could maybe hear the car coming. And then as we saw a car approach, maybe there were diapers hanging out the window. Maybe there was loud singing going on within the car, but we would shout out, "They're here, they're here." And we would all run and gather together. And it was a very special time. There was bonding that happened that it's hard to explain. And I know that that continues in the families that are here today. And it's something that Uncle Dave and his brothers and his sister taught us about family and how important it is to get together. So I think of Uncle Dave and I think of what a strong man he was. I think of that sense of humor. And Una, I think of you today. I know that you were very special to him. I also think of my Aunt Vera, and just the other day I was going, in preparation for this, I was going through some of my dad's letters. He wrote home every day that he was overseas in the war, and what lo and behold should I find is a letter from Aunt Vera to our Grandma Cline, which I'll give to the family after that. It was the only one tucked between all of Dad's letters, so I thought that was really interesting. I just want to say, you know, how special the family is, and I want to say that these words are shared on behalf of the families of Peter and Margaret Cline. We'll always remember that special time in the summers, and we'll always connect again and again, and no matter the distances and the time that goes by, we're always so pleased to share something that Uncle Dave shared with us and instilled in us. He did he and John came to my mom's funeral, and it was at the Zelma Cemetery, and for those who know Zelma, the cemetery, you can look out to the Cline farm. And he read scripture, and he was so gracious and so loving and caring and attentive to us all there. He knew how to create that space for us and how to worship with us. And I thank him for all of that. So bless all of you and know that our sympathies and condolences are with you.
Good afternoon. I'm John Cline, son of Fred Cline, and nephew of David Cline. And my father, Fred, who is Uncle Dave's younger brother, is here. And they were best friends throughout their whole lives. Dad, if you can you stand up, just so everyone can see? So this is Fred Cline. Sitting next to him is Uncle Steve, Stephen Cline, if you want to stand up. We are blessed to have him here today. And then standing with Dad is my dear wife, Joy. So you can be seated. So I'll just share quick things. Uncle Dave, as we have heard from so many, was so welcoming. And he always treated me kindly. He listened to and valued what I had to say. And he would tell jokes and stories. When I became a medical doctor, whenever we came to visit him, Uncle Dave would, as soon as he would see me, he would say, "There's a doctor in the house." And then he would say, "Oh, doctor, I've got this pain." He said, "Can you help me with this?" And I would always say, "If you just give me your health care number, I'll answer anything you have to say." The second is a quote from Isaiah 61. Verse 3. And these are wonderful words for us today. Promises for us. He gives beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning. He gives us a garment of praise for the spirit of despair and heaviness. That we might be oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified and display his splendor. Whenever I would stand next to Uncle Dave, I would get this feeling that I'm standing next to an oak of righteousness. All of us here, we bear the fruit of Uncle Dave's choice and decision not to become a lawyer. Apparently, after the war, he was set on becoming a lawyer. And he was in pre-law, and Aunt Vera, she prayed hard that year because she knew she was going to be married to a pastor, not a lawyer. So Uncle Dave, he became instead a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So the song that we will be singing shortly is called "Take Up Thy Cross." I never heard it before, but it's really a wonderful old hymn. And the refrain goes, "Take up thy cross and follow me. I hear the blessed Savior call. How can I make a lesser sacrifice when Jesus gave his all?" That was Uncle Dave.
So my name is Randy Cline, and I'm the eldest son of Uncle Dave's younger brother, Ellis, and I'm very honored to be here today to share a few words on behalf of our family and a little bit from the wider family, too. It's especially a blessing because my dad's brothers, his siblings were, his brothers along with my Aunt Ethel were very, very special to him. So I think what I'll do before I start in my remarks from our family, John's asked me to read an email that was sent by my Uncle Phil, and I know he would have really liked to be here today. He lives in St. Catharines, but he's also in his early 90s, so he just couldn't make it. So he's asked if we read a little bit of a reminiscence from him. So this is from Uncle Phil. "David was 5 years older than me. He was therefore the big brother who looked out for me both at school and in later years. He was always a hard worker and encouraged, if not bossed, those of us who were younger. He was greatly loved and followed. When he joined the RCF at the age of 19, he eventually earned his wings as a pilot and flew off the east coast of Canada searching for enemy submarines. His coastal duties required him to fly an amphibian Canso and later a B-24 bomber, and thus he assumed a heroic status in the eyes of his younger brothers. In 1946, he purchased a lot in the then town of Sutherland for the sum of $1 and built a house. I was drafted to assist in the construction of that house as a summer job. After discharge from the Air Force, he became a candidate for the Christian ministry and influenced both Brother Fred and myself to follow his example. He and Vera generously provided room and board for me in my early years at university, as they also did for Fred. Vera tried her best to line me up with a suitable bride, but in that respect, I made my own choice. And since Audrey and I have been together for nearly 67 years, it proved to be a wise choice on my part. Dave performed our wedding ceremony at the old Mayfair United Church in Saskatoon, and obviously did a good job. During my early years in ministry, he was both a valued advisor and a mentor to me, even if I didn't always follow his advice. Dave was a gifted and well-loved pastor and preacher, as well as having a great interest in the organization of the church. Now, after many years of faithful service to our Lord, he's gone to the other side and is without a doubt busy reorganizing over there. Go in peace, Dave, and the Lord be with you and yours. From Brother Phil. So it's great that Uncle Phil could share some words from a distance. And I want to say a few words on behalf of our family. My Uncle Dave is a caring and encouraging brother-in-law and uncle in the life of our family. He was actually the minister who married my dad, Ellis, and my mom, Maureen, and he assured my parents that he tied good firm knots. My mom always felt supported and encouraged by Dave and Aunt Vera. She recalls a trip to Calgary where I was very fretful and upset, and Uncle Dave, ever loving a road trip in his big car, was sure that a car ride would definitely make things right. And so, a lunch was packed, and he led everyone out on an expedition to Banff. I'm not convinced it provided a cure, but it was definitely a kind-hearted gesture, and I'm sure it was a welcome diversion for my mom and dad. My family lived our whole lives in Sutherland in Saskatoon, and as you heard in Uncle Phil's note, it was Uncle Dave who led us to the promised land with his suggestion that my parents should buy that little house he built there in his $1 veterans lot. So it was really Uncle Dave that brought us to Sutherland. I always enjoyed Uncle Dave's visits to our place and the sage advice he offered during our occasional golf outings. I appreciated his wry sense of humor and the way he always seemed to be just on the edge of a chuckle. However, what our family will always remember the most about Uncle Dave is his generous spirit. One restless night when my dad was dying of cancer, my dad told my mom about his favorite Christmas, and I wanted to share Dad's actual words rather than summarizing them. It was 1943, and Dave was coming home on leave. It was about 40 below zero. Sounds like Saskatchewan. I remember the excitement as we finally saw that old steam engine come around the bend in the distance. Then we got home, and Dave had this big bag of presents. There was even one for Mother, and she hardly ever got much of a present. When I opened up mine, it was a box of Tinker Toys. It was the best Christmas present I ever got. I'd hardly ever gotten a toy before. We usually got socks, and Mother knitted warm mitts for everyone. I don't remember what everybody else got, but everybody got something special. I played and I played with those Tinker Toys, and I wondered if I would ever make a little boy that happy. Dave was always very generous. Uncle Dave's generosity extended down through the years, from that moment when he made his young village Christmas so memorable, to those visits when he made the long journey from the coast, to sit laughing over Cline stories with my dad, bringing comfort to my parents in Dad's final days. We joined the rest of the family in grieving over Uncle Dave's death, but we also celebrate what he meant to our family throughout a life well lived. Thanks for the opportunity to share a few words.
My name is Rebecca, and I'm the youngest granddaughter, and I'm John Cline's daughter. When I think about Grandpa, there are many things that come to my mind. His sense of humor, his great stories. Sometimes, you know, the stories would change as they were, the more that they got told. How hardworking he was playing cards with him, even though he would bend the rules at times. And he was a pilot in the Royal Canadian Air Force. But the three things that stand out to me most about Grandma was his generosity, his unconditional love for his family, and his love for the Lord. These three things, to me, are interwoven with each other. Grandma has always been generous. He was generous in giving gifts, but also very generous with his money. I know that he has given all of us in his family money over the years, whether it was supporting ministries, giving his birthday money, or physical gifts. And the birthday money would often match the amount of our age. He was always generous. After all, it was just money. I have many fond memories spending time with Grandpa and Grandma as a child. We lived in Alberta, and so we would often come out to visit. And whenever we'd go, their house was always filled with pictures of their children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. There was never any doubt that we, their family, were loved and valued to them. When I was little, one of my favorite things to do with Grandma and Grandpa when we would come out to visit was to crawl into bed with them in the morning and pray and do devotionals with them. Yeah. I was and am still so challenged for their love and devotion to the Lord, and the fact that they prayed for people by name every day and spent time daily reading the Bible. I know that many of us in this room, including myself, are Christians because of the constant prayers that we received from Grandma and Grandpa over the years. I am so grateful to be part of this amazing legacy of Grandpa, David Cline. I'm thankful for his dedication, his service, and his love for his family and to the Lord. Even though he never got to receive his letter from the Queen, I know that he received something even greater. Because of his relationship with the Lord, Grandpa is now in heaven, reunited with Grandma, those who have gone before him, and even better, Grandpa is now with God for the rest of eternity.
Hello. Oh, I shouldn't have said hello because Grandpa never said that to me. What he would say to me is I would come and I'd say, "Hey, Grandpa," and he'd say, "Who are you? Somebody ought to cut you off at the knees." Every time. But my name is Matthew, and I'm the youngest grandchild in our family, so I guess that's why I go last to the grandchildren. I mean, it's been said so many times, and he's so funny, but my wife, the day that Grandpa died, asked me, "If you were to describe your Grandpa, what would you say?" And I said, "Funny, kind, and welcoming." And the word welcoming has been interesting, because since then, whether it's on Facebook or in person, I've probably heard 5 or 6 other people say how welcoming he was. He was such a great guy. And a couple of jokes that I liked of his were, lately, it seemed like the last couple of years he came up with some new ones that he pretended he just always said, but I was like, where did this come from? This is new. But one that he liked in the last year or so was people would ask him, how long have you and Una been married? And he'd think, and he'd go, 128 years. 55 for me, 55 for her, and then together, 18, almost 18 for the both of us. And always with that wit in his eyes, and sometimes he'd point and laugh, and he loved it. But imagine the man who's married 55 years to his first wife and almost 18 to his second, 73 years in his life committed to a wife. It's an amazing legacy that he gave just in marriage and also in faith. Another thing that probably most of you guys know is that when he would say his age, he'd always say 1 year above. It was funny, I think it was Boyd said to you, my almost 96-year-old grandfather, and I thought that's very fitting that you said that to start the service, because he was only 95, but when he met our son, who's also David Cline, his great-grandchild, he kept saying, "Imagine 96 years between us, looking at a 96-year-old man." And he was 95. But in his 96th year, and he just loved that joke his whole life. Can you imagine, though, in heaven, he Say, I just picture one of Jesus and one of people and saying, this is so good, I think I'm going to be here for a year past eternity. And as Rebecca said, he'd sometimes change details a little bit, so I imagine Jesus saying, it doesn't quite work like that, and him going, I don't care, it's my story, I'll tell it how I want to tell it. I remember as a kid going into bed with Grandma and Grandpa and doing devotions with them, and it stood out to me, it always did. And there's pictures of us, of Rebecca and I being in bed with them and reading the Bible and just seeing their commitment to the Lord and how they do that every day and do it together. And you just think of the legacy when you look at his offspring, which he was so proud of, and he'd just say, oh, it's my joy and my honor to be obedient to the command to be fruitful and multiply. And that was in both in number but also in faith. And you look at the legacy that he's left in his kids and his grandkids. And he would just want every person here to know Jesus and to know him so well. And even if you know Jesus, to know him more and more all the time. To the point where the last conversation that I had with him a month ago, I said to him, what are you reading now? Because he was always reading. And he said, well, I'm reading this book on the Apostle Paul. And he was so excited to tell me the new things that he was learning about Paul. And I just thought, this man is like almost, well, in his 96th year, and still learning, and still excited to learn about the Lord, and about his disciples, and about Scripture. And so I just know that his heart for every person here would be to, number one, know Jesus, and to know him better all the time. And we were talking last night about his last moments, and the peace that he had, people that were with him, watching him, the peace that he had, knowing that he was going to go. And over the last couple of years, talking more about heaven and just the excitement and the joy that he had. And you think, if you don't know Jesus, there's this, you don't know, you don't have this peace in your soul, but he had it. And so I know that every person, he would want that for every person. And like Rebecca said, she kind of stole my line, but he always talked about receiving a letter from the Queen, which you get in Canada when you turn 100 years old. And he didn't quite get there, but he did receive an entry letter from the King, and I know that he's going to be there forever, and we know the Lord, we're going to see him again. So, Grandpa, I love you, and thank you.
My cousin, John Charles, has mentioned that we're going to be singing Take Up the Cross, and John and I will sing it as a duet, and Randy, a Cline, will play on the piano. There's a tradition whenever clients get together of clients singing together. And so we're just doing this in a very limited way today with John, Charles, and I. But we'll be singing four verses in the chorus. So anytime you feel familiar with the words of the chorus, please join in with us on the chorus, if you would. Just a few words before John and Randy and I sing Take Up Thy Cross. I have three things to say about Dad quickly. The first is that when I was a boy, I was very blessed to have my mom being such a committed Christian, and she would take my sisters to Canadian Girls in Training, Christian Girls in Training, CGIT, every Tuesday evening, and that was my special time with Dad. And we did the same thing every Tuesday evening for years. We would go to the basement and we would take shots. And we'd have three periods, 10 shots each. And apparently he did this when he was a boy with Uncle Fred and Uncle Phil. And there's a famous story of one time Uncle Phil was, they always put him in goal because he was a young guy. And Dad raised the puck and got him in the forehead, and Uncle Phil had to be rushed to Young Saskatchewan, where he was stitched up, and he still bears the scar from my dad's shot. So we would take shots, then we would go upstairs, make sure we were there by 7:30 when the Flintstones came on. Every Tuesday, we would watch the Flintstones and we would play Lo Rummy cards and then 31 in cards. We would play that, and then we would watch the Jack Benny show at 8 o'clock. And by 8:15, Dad was done with me, and he sent me to bed. And it was a wonderful, wonderful growing up thing. And so when Matthew was a boy, he and I would take shots, three periods, 10 shots each. And I've promised David, though he doesn't understand what I'm saying, as soon as he's old enough, we're taking shots. We're going into the basement and taking shots. The second thing I want to say about Dad is that when I was 18 years old, Dad went to a camp, a Christian ashram camp, and my mom had given her life to becoming a follower of Jesus when she was 16 years old. Dad never made that commitment. He was a good churchman. He was essentially, as he said, a Unitarian. He believed in God, the Creator. He was a moral person, attempted to keep the Ten Commandments and honor God. He attempted to make a difference in society. My mom prayed for him for years and years and years that he would come to know Jesus. And so I was 18 years old, the summer of 1974, and Dad went to this United Christian Ashram camp, and he came back. I hadn't gone. My mom, my dad, and my sister Janice had gone. And Dad came back after the camp, and he said to me, we were sitting in the living room, our house on Oak Street, and he said, John, I want you to know I've become a Christian this week. And I said, what do you mean? What have you been on these years? And he said, well, I believed in God, but now I'm a follower of Jesus. And he said, you need to become a Christian too. And so in the following year, then I studied the Bible and I read like never before. In the following year, then when I was 19, I went to that same United Christian Ashram camp and I gave my life to following Jesus. And then the third thing I want to say about Dad is that he said to me that after he became a Christian, Jesus freed him from the curse of perfectionism, that he tried so hard in his own effort to do things perfectly, and that when he met Jesus, he realized that on the cross, Jesus forgave him all of his sins and took away the curse of perfectionism, and he could just rest in Jesus' arms, knowing that he was loved and accepted. And so John Charles and I, with Randy on the piano, we will now sing Take Up Thy Cross. And once you know the chorus, please join with us. Oh, I should also add, my mom chose this song for Dad and I. And so we've sung this song, Dad and I, in so many churches across Saskatchewan, Alberta, and BC. So John Charles will be singing Dad's high tenor part, and I'll be singing the alto or bass part.
so much to John and your family and sharing that, and also the song we listened to. It's always good to hear about the cross of Jesus. And you know, it's in the times we are living in, is a lot of the people, churches or pastors, are eliminating the cross and the blood, and we should never do that, because if we do, there's no message anymore. Let us sing and respond to that by singing "When the Roll Is Called Up Again."
And joy he gives.
was wonderful to listen to all the testimonies. And as we will be going out, I think there's one message that we need to take with us. God has sent his son Christ to search for the lost. So when he do find us, he invites us to come with him and to be with him as well. And David's testimony of his life is that God found him. He accepted him as a savior, and therefore he knew that God would come back to him once his room was finished to be with him. But I think to all of us as family and friends, there's still a message from the man who passed away from here to eternity. I think that he is begging us, asking us to walk that same way, so that one day we will be reunited in heaven to spend time together with a glorious God, a gracious God. So let's accept that offer and do what he did as a man of his life. Let us now all stand. I'm going to do the benediction here, and then the family. I will lead the family out to the memorial garden where Fred Cline will officiate on the interment. And you as friends and family, you can please wait for us for our return in the center hall. And now it's my prayer that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Not true. So I think Uncle Fred and Aaron and Uncle Steve and Aunt Sharon.
Not here yet.
Yeah. Okay, so they'll come in and Janice. Janice and Anne and Alva. And I.
Mom, can you leave the walker out?
And I'll steer out.
Fred and Steve.
Yeah. Fred, we need Uncle Fred in here.
Where's Uncle Steve?
And Rick?
Uncle Steve and Aunt Sharon and Ann.
I think Auntie Janice. I think it's just the siblings in there. And then
Where
is the actual site?
It's over here, in the front. You'll see it, don't worry.
Where's Grandma Una?
I think we're wheeling her out. Uncle Fred's coming.
Do you want me to go look for her?
What about the street?
I'll go look for them.
Straight in the garden.
Oh, in the garden.
Right. Matt's gonna go with the
baby. Okay.
Where do we
stand?
There.
All right. Yeah.
We have a few more to come in here, Uncle Fred.
Would you like to sit out? Okay.
Auntie Sharon and Uncle Steve.
Auntie Sharon and Uncle Steve cleared all of the flower, all the bushes, and she brought the flowers, and there's a cross over there.
Yeah, so you open, and then you have Sharon.
There's
Sharon.
So you want to go in?
You'll need to make a path. You just got to get through.
Guys, Grandma Eunice just coming behind.
Get
your feet up, Grandma, and I'll push you.
I am the resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, as much as your labor.
but it's not a thing in the Lord. Into God's keeping we commend our brother, our friend David, departed. We commit his body to the ground, to the elements, to the earth, to the ashes and the dust, trusting in God's great mercy by which we have been brought anew to a living through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
Got it.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
no, they'll take you.
Or there were some
pastry.
Yeah,
I think this is
shady.